thing. So he switched to the mom, and it's not because he's still asleep.
Are you sure?
But it was not the main, you know, the main situation. So today we will continue with video-driven systems. But first, maybe let me ask whether you, after sleeping, you have any questions about what Norman and I talked about yesterday. No? So then we'll continue with video-driven systems. And in particular, we would be interested in the interaction effects. And first, you know, probably something you've seen, a little experiment showing why periodically driven systems can be interesting. So here you have just a pendulum, and you're driving its suspension point, and you increase the driving frequency. So as you increase it, so you see that something very interesting happens. So at some point, you can find a new stable state, right? And that's a very simple illustration why you have to be interesting. So you can give you new states that are not stable in equilibrium. So now, from the cartoon, let's go to the simple formulas. So essentially what we want, right, we want to consider a quantum system with a Hamiltonian that depends periodically on time. So we call this period T, and so far I would not, you know, assume anything else about the Hamiltonian. So just that this is periodically dependent. And so we know we should solve Schrödinger equation, right? So it's just now with a time dependent Hamiltonian. You know, you immediately realized that normally what you do, you solve the static Schrödinger equation, so you find the eigenstates, right, and their eigenenergies, and then you can analyze dynamics starting from some initial state. So, but here, you know, because of this time dependence, we no longer have energy conservation, right, and therefore there isn't, strictly speaking, doing such a concept as a ground state. So it is something new, and the way to describe it is, in some cases, is to consider the, instead of the Hamiltonian, is to consider the evolution operator over one period. Right, so here you see I have this time ordered exponential, and that's because Hamiltonians at different times do not have to commute with each other. And you can immediately see that if I know the properties of the Fourier operator, right, I would at least know what my system is doing at integer multiples of the driving period, right? Because if I know that, again, so I know, you know, what the system will do after time t, and then I can multiply again by u of t after 2t, and so on, right? And you know, u of t, that's a unitary operator, and it would have, you know, I can find its eigenbasis. Right, so let me call those guys psi n, and corresponding eigenvalues, so they must have, they must be absolute value 1 because it's unitary. So I can write it as just a phrase, e to the minus I, e n, t. And this, you know, this quantity e n is called quasi energy, and this is called Fourier eigenstate. Right, so you will see some parallels with what we know from static Hamiltonians, but there would be also new things. And you know, first funny thing is that quasi energy is actually periodic, right? You see, I can take En and shift it by 2 pi n over t, and nothing will change. Right? So it's only defined modulo 2 pi over t. You would also say that it lives on a circle, similar to the quasi momentum in the solid. Right, so there are some analogies with quasi momentum. So let's consider non-interacting crystal, for example, and let's say we are driving it. And what you can imagine is that driving, you can use driving to control your effective band structure. Right, so in particular, you can imagine that you know, we with a cleverly chosen driving, you can make some topological constructs. So, and then, you know, you can, similar to how you plot bands for Hamiltonians, you can plot the quasi-energy bands in them. So I would have some bands as a function of quasi momentum. It must be 2 pi over t periodic in this direction. And again, so let me begin. I think that what is important that there is no, you know, there is no hierarchy of quasi-energy, right? So I cannot say where the ground state is, I cannot define Fermi energy. Right? So that should be kept in mind. So one way in which you can imagine you would do that, right? You would control that structure. You would say, well, so I have this unitary operator U of t, right? And indeed, it is, you know, originally it is some time ordered exponential of your Hamiltonian. But I could imagine, well, I can probably write it as an exponential of some effective Hamiltonian, right? Because, you know, we want our static intuition back, right? And you can formally, of course, do it, right? So it would be just a Hamiltonian which has the same eigenstates as your Floki operator. Of course, it's not unique, because I can shift, right? Eigenstates are fixed, but the eigenvalues aren't. I can shift every eigenvalue by 2 pi n over t. Actually, any eigenvalue, right? There comes truly a lot of freedom in choosing this Hamiltonian. But so, you know, turns out that the existence of a physical local Hamiltonian is actually not guaranteed, and we'll talk more about it. Right, but you can sort of naively imagine that, you know, you can try to engineer such a drive which would make this H effective topological. Right, and a lot of girls did just that. So some, you know, this has been very interesting because it's possible experimentally. Right, and here's a couple of examples. So here is one example of an optical lattice driven by a couple of lasers, and then the idea is that, you know, you have cold atoms in the lattice, and if you want to study, for example, quantum cold physics, it is a bit difficult, right? Because normally the way you study quantum cold physics, you apply a magnetic field, and you have lambda levels. These atoms are neutral, so they don't respond to magnetic field, right? But driving can break that reversal, and if it's chosen very, you know, in a very clever way, you can actually get effectively very strong magnetic fields. Right, so here you can get some flux for blockade. So let me not go into the details of this drive, how it works, but yeah, ask me if you're interested or not. And then so it turns out that by changing the parameters of the drive, you can actually drive the system from the topologically trivial to the topologically non-trivial region. So you can effectively realize how bank-like model with non-zero Chernow, which would have, you know, and moreover, a very nice thing, so this Chernow number can be directly measured using very nice trick of essentially it is an interferometry combined with block oscillations, right, which allows you to measure very phases. And that's an interesting subject in itself. So but let me just mention briefly, you know, such that you know what people use Floquet for. And there are many nice ideas, you know, imagine that by driving you could control semiconducting quantum wells and maybe make them into a quantum spin hole state or something like that. So, but let me now spend a couple of slides telling you how people normally calculate this effective Hamiltonian. And don't take it as a sort of final truth, right? So I'll just tell you what is done, and then we'll discuss when it's valid and when it's not valid, how should one So the limit in which indeed you can say something about the spectrum experimentarian is the high frequency limit. Right? So let's imagine that you know driving frequency is very high or the period is very small. Right? And let me look again at this block algorithm. So by definition, it is a time order exponential of this integral of h of t. And then we want to write it as an exponential of some h effective. And formally, you could say, okay, so h effective is just the log of u of t, right? And again, so as I said, it's not unique. To construct the physical effective Hamiltonian, what you can try to do expansion in 1 over omega, provided this frequency is high. And this is just a math problem, right? So you need to expand this exponential into orders because you see the smallness comes from the integral, right? So it's proportional to t, this integral. And then you have to expand it, well, on the right side, and then order by order, you have to match, right? And, that's actually an exercise you can do at least for the first couple of orders. And what you find is the expression for h effective as a series as goes as 1 over omega, right? So it's series in 1 over omega. And first term would be just the time average Hamiltonian. Second term would involve a commutator of h at different times. And then at higher orders, you get more and more commutators. Right. And this is called sometimes high frequency expansion, sometimes Magnus expansion. So that's the idea. Right? Now, of course, as with any kind of expansion, right, we should ask ourselves when does it converge to what do we need for it to work? And strictly speaking, this converges only if the normal Hamiltonian is small, only if the normal Hamiltonian at any instance of time times the period is less than pi. And this is perhaps a simple example where you can see that is Baker-Hausdorff formula. So if you haven't seen it, don't worry. So let's consider driving, which is quite special. So where I'm just switching periodically my Hamiltonian between H0 and H1. Right, so every half period I switch and then I switch back. So it's a kick protocol. So I just kick my system every half period. And then so I can try to represent this problem of finding effective Hamiltonian. So it boils down to representing the product of two exponentials of non-commuting matrices A and B, right? Defined like that via Hamiltonians as a single exponential. Right. And I don't know if you guys ever encountered it, but this you would see in a lot of contexts. Right? And you can what I mentioned on the previous slide, so the series would give you A plus B plus some commutator B and A, and then there will be more and more commutators. And there are many nice math papers which discuss when this would converge, and they all roughly give you this. So they might disagree about some exact number here, and once the number is a little bit improved, a new paper is written. But for us, all is important is order one. Right. And since we're interested in many body systems, we should ask so whether Magnus expansion is actually convergent for many body systems. Right. And more generally, how do we even approach this problem of a driven many body systems? Right. For now, let's say high frequency. Right. So we learned somehow, we learned the intuition, and we learned the formulas. And the most obvious effect. Right, which often when people discuss various clever driving protocols was kind of a bit put aside, right? So don't driven systems heat up, right? Don't you useless in a sense because you would heat up, right? And heating up means that there is no conserved energy. Right, so is this point clear that if you have an effective Hamiltonian which is physical, right, this would mean essentially that that you have new notion of energy, right, and therefore there would be no sort of strong heating. Is it okay? So and you know it is a challenge that we should understand how heating can be avoided. Right? Yeah, that's what happens essentially. And it turns out that was one of the very 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 nice applications of MBL, right? It turns out that if you have MBL, it can persist in the presence of periodic driving under certain conditions, and this would suppress heating. Right? And that opens the door to new equilibrium phases, and so norm now. Woke up. We'll tell you about one such phase, which is time based. And there's another way you can imagine you can find heating. So you can just find particular physical situation where heating is slow, and then you can imagine that you have this window before the heating time, right? And then your system will do interesting things, and then eventually it will start heating. And that's called pre-thermal phases, right? And this is a particular kind of pre-thermalization, so people mean many different things by pre-thermalization, so keep that in mind. There isn't, yeah, it's just, to my mind, it just means that there is some very long time scale at which your system truly starts thermalizing, and before that, it's still, let's say, quasi-equilibrating and doing something interesting. Okay? And I will tell you about one case of that in trivial systems. And, you know, perhaps not surprisingly, case, rather general case where heating turns out to be slow is if you're driving a many-body system at high frequency. And that's what I will tell you about. But now, you know, before we go on, maybe let me ask you a question so you don't have to answer it, but I encourage you to think about it. So, you know, I just told you, well, if you have a many-body system and you drive it, it will heat up. Right, so why is that? Right, so do you kind of see why this in general would be the case?
Any ideas?
So let's say I take a thermalizing system in the way that, you know, we described yesterday, which satisfies the TH. And I drive it, so why?
So after like 30 PTH, after sufficient long time, which is like the density goes thermal, right?
So well,
like, you know, also an ensemble which makes sense.
Well, we did not really talk about time dependence yesterday, right?
So
if
PTH was set at all, kind of look thermal, and particularly look thermal with respect to their conserved quantities, but in this case because we have no conserved quantities, so each eigenstate look like a identity.
Yeah. Well, so this is in the right direction, but let's so you know think about it a little bit. We'll go on, right? And then if we have 5 minutes, we can come back to this question. Right, but now, so let me start actually with this high frequency driving limit, but now in many body systems. And the intuition is actually, for what I'm going to say, is quite straightforward. So let's say we have fermions on the lattice with some Hamiltonian, you know, H0, so that would be the interacting fermions on the lattice. So for example, I have, you know, hopping just like we had yesterday, plus I would have nearest neighbor interaction just like we had yesterday, right? And I would not put in this order, right? I don't need this order at the moment. And we would drive it somehow, for example, by periodically shaking the latest a little bit or something like that. Exact form of the driver is not really important. And let's say I start out my system in a ground state, right? So it would be, well, very, very naively, I would draw this picture, and so you're feeling all the states below energy zero. Now, of course, as from TD course, of course, you know that interactions would modify this, but let me not worry about it. And then I'm driving it with a frequency that is high, so H omega would be much greater than J and V, for example. And what I need to do to heat up, I need to absorb photons, right? But you see that in order to absorb one photon, right, so photon would be like some big energy like that, right? I need to create a lot of electrical pairs. So I'll need to bring this guy here, this guy there, right? I mean, it should be such that the kinetic energy of this particle called pairs can compensate for the energy of the photon. So number of this particle pairs would go as h omega over j, right? But this is also a kind of process, you know, which would come at high order. Right? It would come at high order. You're observing one photon, right? So it would come at first order in G, but exciting multiple electrical pairs would only come as a high order process in the interaction. Does it make sense? So, because you see, so intuitively what happens, you're trying to absorb a photon, right? First order golden rule does not allow you to do that, right? Because you can only move create one particle called hair pair. So it will be energy J. Then you have to go to the next order, and next order, and next order, and the only way this can happen, right, is if you involve interaction. Right, so very naively, I would write, well, at weak interaction, this process would be suppressed as V over H bar omega to the power of N. Right, so it's very strongly suppressed. So does it make sense, guys? And this is a bit reminiscent of the double decay in the large U Hubbard model, right? Because there, and very briefly, there the story was that if you have a Hubbard model with large U and you create a double, right? And this double wants to relax, it has to give this large energy to the spin excitations, right? And then strongly suppressed, and we were both experimenting that. Experiment, I guess, from Zurich, right? And theory from Eugene's group. And you see, so this is very intuitive, right? Now, if you try to make it kind of more precise in this context, you run into some trouble, right? If you just perceive kind of naively light perturbation theory. Why is that? Well, first of all, it could be, you know, it could be that V is comparable to J, right? And then, you know, then this estimate that I did here would not work. It could be also my initial state is not so simple, right? So you see that there are a lot, and first and foremost, just there are so many higher order processes, and you need to worry about summing them, right? So that's complicated. So instead, actually, let me do something else. So instead, let me involve some relatively simple tricks, which are really, you know, people use in quantum information all the time, and we will prove a little theorem about this heating. So I'm going to consider exactly the same situation. It could be fermions on the lattice or spins. Right? So for example, I could consider this model that, you know, Norm was writing yesterday, with or without disorder, I don't really care. And yeah, I will drive it in some way. So the only thing I would insist on is that all the operators involved are locked, right, in the sense that they act on just finite number of nearby spins. And let me first look at the linear response heating rate. Starting from some state beta, right, so I'll just write the golden rule. So I need to think, well, there will be also G somewhere here, but let me not worry about it. So it would involve matrix elements between driving operator and the eigenstate beta and alpha, and you have this delta function, right, which ensures that you absorb a photon, and then you excite your system from. Your system essentially absorbs the corresponding energy. And let's prove the following theorem that this linear response heating rate goes as the volume of the system, so it's just number of spins n, times the exponential of minus omega over j. Right, so if omega becomes large, you see that this becomes extremely small. And this exactly reflects the intuition that I showed you on the previous slide, right? That absorbing one photon and rearranging a large number of particles, that's hard. That's not what system likes to do. But you know, the cool thing about this little theorem is that it tells you that to show that you don't need to assume anything about weakness of interactions and initial state it just works essentially due to locality of your problem. And proving this actually is not very complicated, so let me you know, take the liberty of showing you one slide with formulas. And if you find it curious, follow, if not just space out for 1 minute, and then tune back in. So, and the reason why I want to show it, so I just want to give you kind of a flavor for how some of the quantum information tricks can be actually useful, right, for problems like that. So I have this expression, right, which involves delta function and the matrix elements of the driving operator between two eigenstates. And let me first, for simplicity, consider the case when the drive is pure and alone. So I'm just shaking, for example, shaking magnetic field on some site, right, for one spin. So first I want it to be pure and alone. Then, so I'm going to do the following trick. I'm going to just represent this. I'm going to insert commutator of V with H. And you know, so commutator of V and H, I can express it through the matrix element of V between alpha and beta, because these are eigenstates, right? If I have a commutator, I can just act, you know, H acts on B or H acts on alpha, and then I get just omega, because in alpha minus beta must be equal to omega, since I have this delta function. And then I can repeat this n times, and so far it's just inequality. So I can have k commutators here. As a result, I get omega to the power 2k in the denominator, and I have this delta function. And here is where locality comes in. So now I'm going to treat k as a rational parameter, and I'm going to choose it such that I can bound this quantity sort of in the best possible manner. And the key, you know, the key observation is that this kind of commutator, right, you can just use locality and do combinatorics and bound this, right, as norm of V, norm of H would be J to the power K, local norm of H, right, so let me emphasize. So total norm of H would be extensive, right, but this is just local energy scale. And then I have K factorial because of combinatorics, because that's, you know, you find how many commutators you have in here. And then, so you see I have my bound, right, because I'll plug this in here instead of this big expression. And you see nothing because omega is large, right? So at first when I increase k, my bound improves, but then eventually this factorial k kills me. right? And I can just do the simple optimization and find the optimal k, and I will find the order of omega over j times e. And e is just f. E is just e, which is like 2.7. And from here, I obtain the bound that this is less ripple than e to the minus coming over j. Now you can say, well, this is just for the local drive, and indeed, you know, for a drive which is a sum of local terms, you have to work a little bit harder, and you have to involve what is called Lie-Robinson bounds. I don't know if you guys heard about it.
No? I will tell about it.
You'll tell about
I'll
it.
I'll tell about it.
Okay, okay.
But you can explain.
Yeah, yeah, so it's just statement that if you have, for example, a system of spins, right, on a lattice, then the velocity at which correlations propagate would be finite, and you can bound this velocity by some expression, right? Which is very intuitive, and you would say, well, this is just obvious, right? Like a system of spins, of course there would be finite speed of propagation. So, but I think what was, you know, what is very cool and what came with the sort of uprise of quantum information, so people realize that you can use this Lie-Robinson bound to prove various interesting results. So, you know, this is one example, this bound on heating, right? Who would have thought that this has anything to do with speed of propagation in your system? You know, earlier example, you know, and frankly, much more complicated that I mentioned yesterday, so proving that ground states of gut local Hamiltonians have any role that relies extremely heavily on the Lie-Robinson bounds. Retold in the right way. So yeah, keep that in mind, that there is this kind of this potential, right, to use some of the techniques to circumvent, let's say, traditional perturbative treatments, right, that you would sort of naively do. So, okay, guys, any questions here?
To get exponent, don't you need to divide by k factorial?
Don't
you need to divide by k factorial?
To get the potential here.
If I expand.
If you expand. Wait, so the way it works, so I have this expression, right?
Yes.
So I plug it here. And then, so the way it looks. So I have. Let me drop all the irrelevant things, right? So I have j to the power 2k, or omega to the power 2k. Times k factorial squared. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And then so I can use Stirling formula, right, so j over omega over k, whatever k over whatever goes into this formula, right?
Oh, but you use Stirling to approximate k.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right. And then if I just minimize it, right, I find that I have to stop just before the, you know, you can see that once k becomes of order of omega over j, I'm dead, right? So I have to stop just before, and then this adds up to this exponential. Okay, so you could say, well, so far we just proved linear response result. So what about finite driving, which is of course an experimentally relevant case? So here it turns out you can also make progress, which I won't describe how to do it, but again the logic is very similar, and physically I'll tell you why, you know, it's very closely related to what we've seen so far. So it turns out that you can show that, you know, this heating time would be exponentially long, right? And you can ask what's happening up to that time. And it turns out that up to that time, your dynamics is very well approximated by an effective static Hamiltonian, which you compute on the high frequency expansion, right? And you should truncate this expansion at the order, which is exactly, you know, what we saw here. It would be the same kind of optimal order. And the physical interpretation is very simple. So you
can I ask a main question. So here you gave a bound on the linear response term.
Yeah.
But potentially this can be much worse, or this can be much better than the linear response. So is there a way to control this, or to know more precisely how this bound on the linear response term is actually a series bound on the bound, sorry, on the
heating.
The real heating that would take place in the system?
So I think it's clear that it's parametrically good bound. Refactor is not good. Refactor, because it is a kind of gross overestimation. It is. I think it gets the physics right. Right. So it's not a, you know, it's not a crazy bound which will give you much you know, faster heating than in reality. So and we checked in some examples that, you know, it will grow. So heating rate will grow indeed. So this exponential is there, but then of course there can be a coefficient. So it can be. In practice, it can be much slower. And moreover, there are examples when heating is much slower, right? If you have MBL or
because that's what I was thinking, that if you go beyond linear response, actually, you might even saturate or...
Exactly. This is, you know, as all results, you know, if you think about this result, it's very general, right? I tell you, any spin system, any interaction, just locality, and this is true, right? But as with many very general results, right, you miss a lot of interesting phenomena, and you have to work more together. But you know, one sort of continuation of this result, right, is that if your drive is finite strength, right, it's not if it is small, so you linear response, then you can have this quasi conserved effective Hamiltonian, right. So for a while your system behaves as if it has a static Hamiltonian, and then it starts heating up. Right? And that gives you, so that gives you a sense in which this boundless expansion can be used, right, in many body systems, mm-hmm. and the conditions that can be used. Right, so it tells you, well, so you can take it up to this order, right, and then you have to truncate it there, because the next order terms would no longer be perturbatively small, and they would physically, you know, they would give you processes of heating. Right? So all of this is very intuitive, right? It's just you can, so if you think about boundless expansion, right, it just tells you that, well, if the drive frequency is high, then if you absorb a photon and then emit a photon, it will just renormalize the Hamiltonian of your system, right? But there are no absorption processes. And as you go along, right, you can do enough rearrangement in your system that you would actually absorb a photon. And that's where you have to stop and say, okay, well, no more, right? I don't. Next I'll have heating and right. So it's just a way, if you wish, of summing up off resonant processes in a compact way, right, and then realizing that at some point you better stop. But I think what is also interesting, you know, is that in a lot of the works, right, people will do mass expansion to the first couple of orders, and they say, well, I have a time window which is, you know, parametrically large in omega, right, which goes proportional to omega or omega squared. Right. In fact, you see that you have a much broader time window. Right. It is exponential enough. And that's, yeah, so that's pictorially what happens. So your system thermalizes and then it heats to an infinite temperature, provided it is an ergodic kind of thermalizing system. And this also, you know, this opens the door to having pre-thermal phases, right? For example, pre-thermal time crystals and principle any pretty much any phase you like. Right? you can imagine doing it this way. And I don't know if Norm will mention pre-thermal.
Yeah. So
now you can, you know, you can do some numerics on it, and you can see that I mean, effectively, I'm showing how well Hamiltonian constructed by a Manus expansion, evolution operator constructed by a Manus expansion to some order n, right? How well it approximates your true Fokker operator. And what you see here, indeed, you know, it gets better and then it gets worse. Right? So it is, in a many-body system, it is an asymptotic expansion. But, you know, you really need locality for this to make sense. So if you don't have locality, then...
So this is an error sort of averaged over all states.
Yeah, yeah, this is...
So starting from some particular state, you can actually do better perhaps.
Oh yeah, yeah, sure. I mean, so technically I can tell you that, you know, this would be, I think, very nice, and you know, I wanted to do it. Technically, this bounds in the sense, you see, this is very nice, right? Because we just bound commutators, we just bound operators. Right? While if you start from a particular initial state, then actually it's harder, right? It's harder to... But I think, you know, I completely agree. I think there are many physically interesting situations where some states will be very stable and some states will heat up, right? And we don't know yet, right? I think we need some clever trick of how to do this bounds for particular states. But this is a very good direction, and I think many interesting problems. So guys, any other questions? No? Okay, so you know, bottom line, Manus expansion is asymptotic, right? And optimal truncation order grows with omega. So now let me very briefly tell you about MBLM-driven systems, and then Norm will continue from there. So as I said, MBL allows you to suppress heating. And so let me just give you some intuition for, you know, why that is. And now, so let's see, let's take Hamiltonian, which is many localized, so let's say what Norm was writing yesterday, plus some driving. For example, I can imagine just modulating field along x direction. And, you know, so again, I have to study the properties of our Fokker operator. And the qualitative phase diagram looks like that. And I'll explain in a second why that is. So if I fix driving operator and driving strength, and fix all the other parameters, and just vary frequency, at high enough frequency, this would stay localized. In the sense that I still have integrals of motion, information spreads logarithmically, but now I should ask myself about integrals of motion of the Fokker operator, right, or not, because I don't have a static Hamiltonian. And then presumably I make a transition to the thermal phase. And let's just qualitatively ask, so how come that we have a system which is driven but may not heat up? So, and let's take the same model we had yesterday. So we have a lattice, right, and we have some fermions which are localized. So they're sitting in their orbitals, right, with some small corrections induced by interactions. And then I'm trying to drive it. Right? I'm trying to drive it. But you see that, for example, if I try to absorb a photon by moving this particle, it will move between two localized orbitals, right? And their energy, so they would be random, right? And in general, they would not be kind of commensurate with my driving frequency, right? So I cannot do it, you know, typically I cannot do this absorption process in the first, you know, by moving let's say one particle. Then I can say, well, maybe I can move a pair of particles, right, and then match their energy to my H omega. And this is, you see that this becomes the same, essentially the same game we had for MBL. Right? You need to analyze periodic processes and understand whether they remain resonant or not. Right? And without going into detail, so that's the idea, that you're locally your spectral function is discrete and you cannot absorb locally, and then you have to analyze higher order processes and see whether they will restore your continuous spectrum.
So this is again assuming that the frequency is much larger than the bandwidth of the problem.
This helps. Disorder. This helps. So it doesn't have to be, but it helps a lot, yeah. Right, so in principle, it is some combined perturbation theory in, because you know I have parameters G and omega, right? So I prefer G to be small and omega in this order to be large. But there is some, yeah, there is some window in which you can show it, and it also involves a regime where omega is less than this order, but then G should be really small. So, and you know, that's the rough idea. So now let me also mention that I think this part of the phase diagram is pretty clear, right? You can do so you can do this. Horrible perturbation theory and convince yourself that it will stay localized. This part, we know some things about it, but I think there are a lot of things which are not really understood. Because essentially you can make a simple argument based on, you know, the if you have a low frequency drive, right, you can think about non-Gaussian conditions, and then you can mainly argue that there would be delocalizing transitions, right? Whether there are enough delocalizing transitions to truly delocalize you, and how your system heats up and so on, that I think is partially an open question. Yeah.
What's a Landau Zener transition?
Landau Zener transition, yes. So I can. That's actually another way of thinking about driven systems, which is sometimes useful, right? Not always, but sometimes. So let's say I have some h of t, right? Which is periodic. H of t is. So let me. Plot time. And let me plot real-time spectrum. Right, so I have some levels initially, and then they will evolve, right? Maybe they will cross, and then they will come back, you know, they will come back to where they started. Right? And changing frequency just changes the rate at which I'm going through this picture. Because I can fix sort of the shape of the Hamiltonian and then just vary the frequency. And you see that, well, and so you can ask, so let's say if I initialize my system in some eigenstate, what would happen to it? And what would be its final state after one driving period? And so what determines it, right, is how does crossings look like? What is the matrix element and how quickly you pass through them? And that's exactly the Landau-Zener problem, that you start with two levels far away, right, and then they can talk for a little bit. And if you go very fast, you're diabatic, so your state does not change. If you go very slowly, you become adiabatic, so you go like that. Okay. And in between, there is this nice formula due to Landau Zener law. I don't know actually if they derived it, probably somebody else too. And here, you know, we have a many body version of that. With one significant kind of new aspect, that as I take my system size to be larger and larger, my spectrum becomes very dense. And then I'll have lots of these crossings, and you can, you know, you can expect that if you, if your tiny frequency becomes very slow, you would have a lot of crossings which are, you know, which are delocalizing, which would make you be in a superposition of these two states. While if your tiny frequency is high, you would just shoot straight through, right? All the transitions would be diabatic, so you just shoot straight through, and yeah, your state does not really change very much. Make sense? So what I'm just saying, if you know, some of you may encounter this problem, so okay, it's just something that I think is interesting, and again, many things which are not really understood. So, okay, so I have 5 minutes, right? So let me just, well, first let me reiterate, right? So we got this bound, which tells you that heating is very slow, right? Exponentially slow, and this bound is general, so it does not assume this order. And then we have a, you know, story about Floquet, about MBL and Floquet systems, and if that's, you know, if that holds, then we don't have heating at all, right? But we need a lot more than in the first set of results, right? So we need disorder and we need localization, and that can suppress heating, right? So the bound is of course true, but you can do much better than the bound. So that's sort of what Kiri was saying. And so just don't confuse the two. So exponentially slow heating always provided locality, and BL there provided the drying frequency sufficiently high, and provided you started out with a disordered Hamiltonian, which is many better locality. So, and you know, there has been quite a bit of excitement about this, because you can now have Floquet and BL phases, right, which have unusual properties, and you can, even for this class of systems, you can define distinct phases, right, distinct non-equilibrium phases. And the example that, you know, there are nice ongoing experiments on, and Norm will tell you all about the time crystals. And let me just tell you, you know, one little thing in the remaining, whatever, three minutes.
When you say, I'll ask this at the end.
Yeah, okay. So let me actually tell you about a two-dimensional phase, right? So first, you know, let's go back. Let's put all the MBL stuff aside, right, and let's go back to the driven single particle systems. And you can imagine that the fact that quasi energy becomes periodic, right, can enable some new topological phenomena. Because if you have something on the circle, right, then something can wrap around the circle. Right? Because that's the ultimately. You know, a lot of topological phenomena in solids are possible because quasi-momentum is periodic. Right? So you can define your Brillouin zone as a torus, so you can define Chern numbers and so on. So here it's a little bit like that. And the simplest possibility you can imagine that your quasi-energy as a function of Q would actually wind, right? It will start at zero, and then it would end up at 2 pi over T. So it would just wind around this quasi-energy circle. And that, you know, gives you a very nice alternative view of the Thau response. I don't know if you guys seen Thau response. It's essentially, so it's also, have you seen it?
I've heard of it, but I haven't seen it.
Uh-huh.
You have one? You have one?
Well, I don't, but I think, I think Emmanuel does, right? Something in the Thau response.
Not here. I'm not going to talk about it.
So, but again, I don't know if it would be useful, because in principle we could also discuss that in the next lecture, if you think it would be useful. Yeah. Okay, maybe then we can stop here, right? And then we will pick up. So I will finish this piece about, we'll tell you about Tau response, because it is a beautiful thing that we'll again encounter in many places. It just, and from the point of view of closure invariance, it is connected to the quantum Hall effect. Right. Time dependent Hamiltonian in one dimension would be related to the time independent Hamiltonian in two dimensions. Right, and then we'll do that. So we'll do that. I'll tell you a little bit about this driven topological phase in two dimensions called anomalous Flaquier insulator, which can be protected by NDL. And then we'll talk about a very recent and kind of developing story about quantum scars, which may give you another way of non-thermalizing. So let's stop here. So if there's any questions, so I think we can still have a couple of minutes for questions and stay perfect on schedule, right?
Thank you.
Going back to the slide on the MDL thermal transition, if the drive strength were sufficiently weak, wouldn't you expect to stay MDL for very slow drives?
Yeah. So if indeed, so I would try to plot phase diagram. Some argument why here it should go to zero in some power law fashion, right? So G critical, so G goes to some power gamma.
Okay.
So that's a guess. But I think just saying that here if I'm here, for example, right, so G is not too large. Here I will be localized, here I will be MDL. I think here there is a lot of interesting physics and a lot of slow dynamics actually. Right? Because if G is small, so you can't have this level crossing, so they will be between nearby levels, so you will absorb just a little bit of energy, and then yes, this deserves further study.
So when we talk about prethermal states in the Magnus expansion context, that is Hamiltonian engineering, but it's not really non-equilibrium, right? There's still stationary Hamiltonians that if I could make it any other way, I would see the same state as my prethermal state. Or is there something?
Well, I think if you take this story that I told you at kind of face value and just apply it like that, then indeed, so you would have some corrections, right? They can still do interesting things, right? So for example, if you take graphene and you want to open a small gap, you can do it with this, right? And you can open the gap that you like, so that would push you, but if you're right at the phase transition point, you can push it either way with a small perturbation. That's good. But I think there is more to it than maybe Norm will tell you about it. So you can also have other kind of drives, right, which would not naively, where we're doing it. Right, so that actually it goes further than just small corrections to the static unit dynamics. And in particular, we have drives which would, you know, at the first glance would look like they're, you know, we do not satisfy this high frequency condition, right? But then you do, you know, let's say with time crystals. So but then you can go to the alternating frame, and then you would suddenly see that after the transformation, you can again use this theory.